We now turn to our main subject for the afternoon, looking at issues involving the law of the sea, underlying territorial disputes, and the question of how maritime issues and territorial issues can best be settled in the international legal diplomatic process. There are those who say that legal matters should be put aside. We should leave all political matters to the diplomats, and they will negotiate solutions. Of course, as the years go by, some disputes never get settled, and some become increasingly threatening or dangerous. And the question comes up, in those circumstances, can the processes of international law be useful? Of course, in all these disputes that China is involved in and others, each side always claims that law, like God, is on his side. Chinese soft-pedaled a reference to God. But we have this question of, is international law merely rhetoric? Is it something that can be helpful? In October 2012, I published an op-ed in the South China Morning Post urging the nations of Northeast Asia to follow the European model and try to create more useful institutions for solving disputes among them, whether it be Court of Human Rights or a court for settling territorial maritime disputes, which is what I was focusing on. I was criticized by a very sophisticated ex-diplomat of the American Foreign Service who said, I was just totally unrealistic, states were not going to resort to international adjudication, especially Asian states. And he treated me like just an academic who was a fish out of water. And I didn't protest, thinking, well, maybe he's right. But then the next month in the International Herald Tribune, which has become the International New York Times, the then foreign minister of Japan, Mr. Genba, he wrote an op-ed, and I was just amazed because Genba said, you know, we Japanese, we're not like the Americans and the Chinese. We believe in international law. And we have not only, of course, signed up to support the International Court of Justice, but we have agreed to the special protocol that says if another state that agrees to that protocol has a dispute with us and they want to take us to the ICJ, we have to go. That's international law. And if China is so confident about its position on the Senkaku, Diaoyu Islands, let them sue us in the ICJ. Well, I was so excited when I read that. And of course, I knew Genba was about to leave office because his political party was being succeeded by Prime Minister Abe. But I felt, well, this is a little bit hopeful. Maybe I'm not so unrealistic. And Peter Dutton, where's Peter? I saw him. There he is. He and I were having a series of meetings with the legal experts from various East Asian countries. And we met with Japanese, we met with Chinese, we met with Vietnamese. We couldn't seem to make a date with the Philippines. And I thought, isn't it odd? We're likely to be on their side. Why don't they want to meet with us? And then on January 22, 2013, the Philippines launched a bombshell. They brought arbitration under the UNCLOS against China. And that's why they didn't want to meet with us. It was too secret. And since then, I began to feel, well, gee, maybe arbitration does have a role here. Maybe governments and diplomats can resort to it in certain circumstances. Well, this afternoon we have two leading Japanese experts on East Asian political problems, and I'm eager to hear what they say to us about the Senkaku problem, which before the South China Sea erupted was a very serious problem, and it remains a very serious problem. One that Deng Xiaoping had said in the early 70s should be left to the next generation, which might be wiser. I don't know if the next generation is wiser or not, but I'm eager to hear your reflections, Ambassador Takahashi. I've been impressed by my talks with him. He's a highly skilled analytical person with a mastery of diplomacy as well as English, and he has a good sense of humor. So, as we say, O Shita Kudasai, please teach us. Qingzhao.
Well, thank you, Professor Cohen, as always, for your kind introduction. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. As introduced by Professor Cohen, I'm a Japanese diplomat. I have been with Japanese Foreign Service for past 36 years, and this is the only word I know. As you already noticed, this forum for me is set out at the best of the timings. President Trump is now on his way to his first trip to Asia, starting from Japan, and he completed his summit meeting with Prime Minister Abe yesterday night. The major subject the two leaders took up were North Korea, trade, and the third subject is sounds like a little bit unfamiliar word. It is expressed in the Japanese newspaper. The two leaders agreed the importance of keeping and developing open and free Indo-Pacific. Indo-Pacific is somewhat unfamiliar words. We always talked about Asia-Pacific diplomacy, but Indo-Pacific is a slightly unfamiliar word to us. But there is a clear reason for President Trump to propose this. Before I get into the substance, just two things. First is, I'm a diplomat, I'm not a lawyer. And I never belonged to the what we call the legal department of a foreign service in Japan. And as a matter of fact, sorry, Jerry, I tried to delay the timing of our negotiated paper to the legal department as late as possible, because I knew these are the guys who are making comment and trying to ruin the achievement we have made in the negotiation with the other countries. So what I can do today is just put forward before you my personal political observations on two important security challenges in East Asia. One is, of course, North Korea, and the second one is, well, as I already told you, what it means by open and free Indo-Pacific in the future. To me, this is a different way of putting forward how we could coexist with a rising power in Asia, politically and economically. This is a law school forum, so there has to be a legal aspect of the issues that has to be talked about. But I will leave it to my able and young colleague, Renito. He also used to belong to the Japanese Foreign Service, and he found other more interesting things to do, so he quits. But we used to be a colleague, so in the Japanese diplomatic world, I still have a right to tell him that, cover my ass.
Without question.
Okay, let us start with North Korea. I don't have to explain to you the crisis we are facing. As a matter of fact, we have had a long history of negotiations with North Korea over the three generations of dictatorship. One of my good friends, who is really a Korean Peninsula expert, expressed his sentiment about those series of negotiations. He told me, with Kim Il-sung, first leader, he did negotiate, but he didn't keep his promise. Second generation leader, Kim Jong-il, he pretended to negotiate, and we were cheated. And now we have this young leader, Kim Jong-un. He didn't even pretend to negotiate. And with this chart, you can easily see the number of missile launching tests has been increased in a quite rapid pace. And under the Kim Jong-un regime, more than 30 ballistic missile launches and as many as 3 nuclear tests since 2016 to present. And he made himself very clear that the nuclear development is not a subject for negotiation. This is a matter of a survival of his own country. And the technology of their missiles has been shown a quite remarkable progress. We all know between North Korea and Guam, it's about 3,400 kilometers distance. And we have already seen in the latest missile testing, North Korea already achieved 3,700 kilometer distance coverage by their longest ballistic missiles. Of course, there are many doubtful things about the preciseness and the reliability of missile technologies. But I could tell you, one of the most optimistic experts in Washington is now beginning to tell us, probably they are going to achieve the capacity to enlarge their missile coverage to the west coast of the United States, probably in 2 years. So the time is not on our side, but at the same time, options for us are also limited. As we all know, the President Trump expressed himself very clearly, all options are on the table, including military options. But at the same time, I myself used to be posted as a DCM of our embassy in Seoul. And so between Seoul and the 38th parallel, what we call demilitarized zone, is only an hour drive. And we all know that there are probably more than 12,000 long-range artillery has been already deployed along the side of a 38 parallel. And even with the military might of US military forces, we all think it's unrealistic to assume to take out all those artilleries at once just like this. So that means any military option, we have to be thinking about the casualty that entails with this military option, probably in the range of at least 50,000 to 200,000 civilian populations. So what will be the, you know, the options left for us? It's a very difficult question. Actually, Professor Cohen and myself had a little discussion over lunch, and he suggested the only option may be a mutual suspension. And I'm afraid I said that, you know, I'm not really be able to agree with you. What does it mean, the mutual suspension? Actually, the Beijing used the different word for the same kind of notions, what they call the double freeze. The idea of Beijing is to freeze nuclear development on the side of North Korea, and in return, the United States government will cease the joint military exercise with South Korea. And that is a deal they are going to aim for. But, you know, we already had the history of negotiations with North Korea, in which we learned in very bitterly that the freeze is something very difficult to verify. And the freeze is something North Korea can easily cheat us in many ways. And probably we will be ending up with wasting the taxpayers' money quite a lot and achieve nothing. Plus, I already told you, in 2 years' time maybe, North Korea is going to achieve the capacity to hit, at least theoretically, the west coast of the United States mainland. And then the argument goes, the credibility of a nuclear umbrella, what we call the extended deterrence of US over us, over Japan, and over South Korea. The meaning of extended deterrence will not be the same when North Korea achieves the capacity to hit the mainland United States. There are many theories. Some theories go that it doesn't make it is not a big deal, because the conventional armed forces of the US is strong enough to deter the attack of possible nuclear attack from North Korea. Kim Jong-un is not a crazy person. He knows once he pulls the trigger, the US is capable of, virtually diminish the North Korean regime in a matter of days or a week. But is it really the case? I mean, we never have tried the value of the extended deterrence in the real world. So if we get into these uncertainties, there is always danger that North Koreans is going to miscalculate the response from the United States or response from Japan. And this is bring us into the uncharted world. And some of the security experts already begin to say, well, only option for Japan and South Korea is to arm themselves with the nuclear weapons. Well, this is a different subject. You know, if I start to talk about this nuclear option, this is going to take probably 3-4 hours. So I will refrain from that argument today. But what I would like to tell you is that for the time being, the only option for us, as Prime Minister Abe and President Trump agreed, to maintain to keep the maximum pressure on Kim Jong-un. And there are many other ways for us to do it. The sanctions are there, by the way, or by UN Security Council resolutions, but there are room to strengthen it. As a matter of fact, yesterday, Prime Minister Abe announced he will add 35 additional individuals and the North Korean-related companies as a, as a target of the sanctions. It is a unilateral sanction that the Japanese government is employing on top of the UN Security Council resolutions. We would like to encourage the other countries, including China, to follow us, to put more pressure on Kim Jong-un, so that at least the next time Kim Jong-un is showing the sign to coming back to the negotiation table, he will be able to be more serious, and we will be assured, in close cooperation with the United States and hopefully China, that this time negotiation is going to take a different path from the ones we have experienced in the bitter times. Okay, so North Korea is an issue of a clear and present danger for our security challenges. The China is a totally different story, of course. I'd like to stress that, we are not, and I'm not going to talk about the sort of a China phobia type of argument as a threat in East Asia. And I'm not going to talk about the containment of China. We all know it's impossible. China is already a major economic power, and China has already been playing quite a constructive role to assure the global growth in many fields. We know that there are many ambitious and able Chinese businessmen, young generations, already have been coming up with the state-of-the-art breakthrough in their technologies and taking advantage of the huge domestic market of China. They are actually front runners of our future businesses. And we have to recognize it, and we would like to take advantage of it. So the question is, not containing China. Question is not, you know, making them a threat and try to coming up with the countermeasures. The question is how to secure the international environment, especially the East Asian environment, under which Japan, South Korea, China, and Southeast Asian countries, all the Southeast Asian countries, Australia, India, will be able to live in peace and stability and enjoy the economic prosperity, taking advantage of the size and the, you know, the importance of a Chinese economy to Asia and to the world. And then comes the question of what does it mean when President Trump proposed this free and open Indo-Pacific in the future? The word is intentionally used, Indo-Pacific, because we reflect a few years ago, Prime Minister Abe actually proposed the idea of a diamond alliance network. Means that, you know, US, Japan, Australia, and India, those four countries will be the core of a network of the alliances, sharing the same democratic value, sharing the idea that the open and multilateral world trading system is essential for their future. And the other reason why they choose those four countries is Southeast Asian countries, I mean ASEAN, of course, is a very important international organization. But at the same time, in reality, their economy has been influenced so heavily by the Chinese presence. And it is not really realistic for us to expect that ASEAN is going to take a lead in assuring the free and open Indo-Pacific region. And unfortunately, in the past several instances in the ASEAN summit meetings, we have seen the stories where some of the ASEAN countries is clearly taking the side of China and ending up with a very lukewarm and ambiguous document, which is not conducive to our purposes. So this time, President Trump and Prime Minister Abe is in total agreement that we will be coming up with slightly different ideas about creating a network of alliances, network of countries. And I think it is a very important and interesting idea that four countries, Japan, US, Australia, and India, is going to take a lead to assure it. And by doing so, we would like China to join us. We would like China to be a part of a free and open system. I was really impressed by my previous speakers about the Hong Kong stories. And Professor Cohen asked me to be more optimistic. I don't think I'm doing that. But at the same time, there are lessons to be learned from you. And I really hope this time, and now is the time for us, to start to create the network of the countries which will be conducive to see the more constructive and open China for our future prosperity. Thank you very much.
Very good. And now we'll hear from NYU's former student, LLM 2004, Ren Ito, who has continued to be a great supporter of our East Asian, or now I have to say U.S. Asian Law Institute. Ren, please give us your views.
Thanks, Jerry. It is always a privilege to come back to my favorite institution where I studied under Jerry almost 15 years ago. And it's a grateful, such a great delight that I will be joining you in this conversation about discussing this important, interesting subject, which is how we can invite China to work with the other countries and follow, respect, and strengthen international rules and norms. And thank you, Ambassador, for your most comprehensive guidance on what's happening in this area. including your insight on the rule-based community, newly named the Indo-Pacific. And a little bit different from the basic treaty between Hong Kong and the UK, the basic treaty in the Japanese Foreign Ministry has a third-party application still. So even after I left the ministry, I am, we will be helping each other in this again. So let me briefly touch upon what I would like to talk right now, which is about how we can institutionalize. Is there any opportunity or the challenges in terms of institutionalize those dispute settlement, not just by the diplomatic means, but through the legal framework? Let me start with the very basics, which is assessment of the current situation surrounding the East Asia, East China Sea. Up until now, a series of incidents were happening in the East Asian Sea, just as we have seen in the North Korean case, or a lot of intrusion incidents around the Senkaku Islands, including and also the rejection of the UN Convention, UNCLOS Tribunal's ruling in the South China Sea, are the clear examples of how Beijing will respond when confronted by international norms and practices they find unsavory. And in addition to that, I would like to see how the things will be unfolding in the years to come. One thing I would like to highlight from the most recent 19th Party Congress, as everybody does, is Xi Jinping's very firm determination that it will be seeing a more assertive China in the future. One of the examples include, she boldly highlighted the steady progress in the construction of islands and reefs in the South China Sea as a major achievement of his first term, but also he was sending messages to the PLA that they need to be prepared to employ more military power in the future. You can quote a lot more from his policy speech in the 19th Party Congress, but this will be suggesting that international community may face an even more assertive China in the years to come. But that is not the biggest the issues to discuss here. Given that it's likely that China could be becoming more assertive, what can we do to invite China to follow, respect, and strengthen those legal framework and act as a responsible stakeholder in this region? So let me take a few examples from this region. One will be North Korean issue. The other will be Senkaku Islands, and then some other, the maritime disputes, which are happening in the East China Sea area. So starting with the North Korea, it is no secret, just as Ambassador most elaborately explained, it's no secret that Kim Jong-un has tested multiple missiles, conducted a nuclear test, coming closer to being able to launch a nuclear-armed ICBM at the continental United States. No need to stress that this has not only prompted outrage here in the US, but it's a prospect that has been unanimously condemned, even by China, to say nothing of the dismay of Japan and South Korea. And this is the key. In an effort to collectively step up the pressure on Pyongyang, one of the most encouraging developments this year was the UN Security Council has unanimously passed three resolutions to tighten the economic sanctions around the DPRK regime. Of course, behind the debate in the Security Council, there should be a lot of diplomatic pushing and pulling, but the unaccustomed absence of discord was something striking. Discord, including those from China, was something striking. And then here, I would like to see some room for further collaboration, which could be potentially involving China, because for the first time, the Chinese have agreed to impose strict limits on the export of oil to North Korea, which until now was an absolute taboo. And Xi Jinping, in his speech to the 19th Party Congress, hailed China's standing as a world power. And we must find the ways of getting through to them, and at the same time, not just toughening the sanctions regime, but also making doubly sure that enforcing those already in place. And in this respect, again, the Chinese hold a key, and then I see the room that China sees its own merit in joining this multilateral framework and joining the rest of the world in tightening up the economic sanction against China. That's the first tiny illustration about the potential of the multilateral cooperation framework. The second one, the Senkaku Island. Just as Jerry has mentioned at the beginning of the session, I would like to also refer to this op-ed, which was released in 2012 by the then Japanese Foreign Minister Genba, about the potential of adjudicating this in the ICJ. So just as a background, as everybody understands, China is currently challenging the legitimacy of the Japanese sovereignty over Senkaku Islands by sending ships and boats. Of course, whatever the claim is, the unilateral action to change the status quo by force and intimidation should never be the answer. And then this is a challenge, not just to the Japanese sovereignty, but to the rules-based international order. And in this regard, what provides a very interesting insight is this brief op-ed piece, this Genba, Minister Genba, at that moment released to the New York Times, International Herald Tribune, in 2012. If I may quote one sentence from this op-ed, Genba suggested that since China is undertaking various campaigns to promote their assertions in international forum, quote, it seems to make sense for China to accept the jurisdiction of ICJ as comparatively, as Japan does, and take their argument to the ICJ, as just Jerry explained, if they believe they have a legitimate claim. Of course, in this op-ed, this very brief op-ed piece, the then Foreign Minister Genba did not forget to reiterate Japan's official position, which is there exists no issues of territorial sovereignty to be resolved concerning the Senkaku Islands. That's why this make him impossible to raise this case to the ICJ from the Japanese side, and then shifting the burden of proof onto the Chinese side. If Chinese so much believe that this sovereignty question can be legally and legitimately challenged, why don't you bring it to the ICJ by accepting this mandatory jurisdiction, compulsory jurisdiction of the ICJ? This should be interpreted as Japan being so confident in its claim as to expect no scenario of ceding its claim to sovereignty over the islands, but not as refusing the adjudication, not refusing the adjudication for settling dispute over any legal matters. And I think there is one potential here, which is that a country like Japan or any other country which accept the compulsory jurisdiction of the ICJ can leverage on the fact that they have already accepted that. And then they have a legitimate position to invite the other countries to do the same thing and then bring the case to the fair, legal, and equitable solution by utilizing the international or the multilateral forum, whether that is ICJ or something Jerry mentioned as creating a new regional forum. Just one more thing about the Senkaku here is the impact of the Japan-China relations. So this is not a purely legal concern, but in the broader context of Japan-China relations, China's over-reliance on nationalistic sentiment to re-legitimize a post-revolutionary regime is dangerous, as we've seen in 2012 and 2013. Because since while nationalistic sentiments may hold positive potential to overcome a social crisis, they can easily grow out of control and cause a destructive mentality of aggression and limiting the scope of the diplomatic maneuvering. Because of the complex interplay of top-down, state-sponsored nationalism and bottom-up popular nationalism, the leveraging of a nationalism as a source of regime legitimacy is inherently problematic strategy, I have to say. The last thing, which I see as another area which have a potential of utilizing the legal or institutional dispute resolution framework, is other maritime disputes in the East China Sea. Everybody talks about Senkaku Islands and Chinese ship coming in and going out of this area, but that's only a tip of the iceberg. Majority of the maritime disputes are not happening around Senkaku. Majority of the maritime disputes are not diplomatically negotiated or popping up on an international news headline. That's coming out of the day-to-day operation of the fishery boats. The reason is this is deriving from the fact that between Japan and China, the boundary of the exclusive economic zone or the continental shelf are not officially determined. I'm not complaining about the fact that this has not been established yet. I will be talking about the pros and cons of an effort of drawing a crystal clear demarcation line between Japanese and Chinese EEZ and continental shelves. Because, as there are a lot of experts on the maritime law here, but between Japan and China, we have been using a slightly or maybe totally different logic or the thoughts behind how we should be drawing a demarcation line. Just a brief summary is that Japanese believe that 200 nautical miles from the baseline, and then if it's overlapping, it have to be resolved basically by using the principles of the median line with the equidistance principle. Chinese are saying that 200 nautical miles, but if plus some other considerations. In terms of the continental shelf, Japanese again employs the same principle that 200 nautical miles from the baseline could be modified by the median line. Chinese is using this thought about the prolongation of the continental shelf. So, and then even if you take a look at the UNCLOS articles, there is no crystal clear solution which is providing to any countries. The law is nebulous there. It's intentionally kept nebulous because there is no crystal clear established law which was held true by all countries. So what Japan and China have been doing in the absence of the crystal clear demarcation line is that they try to find a practical solution by coming up with a couple of different solutions. The first one of which is something Japan and China struck in 1997, which is a fishery agreement. So in between, so on the both sides of the median line, they put the provisional, the area for this, the fishery. And then in this area, without making any prejudice, so it's the flag state, the sovereignty, a flag state jurisdiction will prevail. And they keep the room for practically solving the matter. The second one is about the maritime scientific research. Because there is no crystal clear demarcation line, China and Japan agree that they will be giving a prior notification to each other when they're conducting the maritime scientific research, for which they don't need to have any special agreement like this if the demarcation line was crystal clear, clearly defined. But in the absence of the crystal clear demarcation line, they come up with this kind of practical and the provisional solution. The third one is about the joint development of the resources underneath the water. But there are a lot of practical solutions which are created by the efforts by the both Japanese and Chinese authorities. But the question is how effective that is. And then enforcement is still the key in this regard. But again, it's not a black and white case. Whether you have to draw the line first or you accept the fact that it's practically difficult to draw the line and coming up with some other solutions. So this is a very brief overview of what is happening in the East China Sea and the surrounding areas and how the law, multinational framework, or institutional solution could be the way to support the diplomatic efforts in clearing all those disputes. Thank you very much.
We have 15 minutes for discussion of this. One question that I have is, what about Japan and South Korea and the Takahashi-Tokto dispute? Has any progress been made there? It seemed to me Japan tried to take Korea to arbitration or adjudication, really, before the International Court of Justice. But The ROK being in possession of these rocks has never accepted that. Has there been any progress on that? Any chance of negotiation? Should a tribunal that could be established handle all these East Asian disputes? You're in possession of the Senkaku and have come close to, but have never acknowledged there's a real dispute there, which looks a little silly, of course. On the one hand, you have had this Genba statement, but has it ever been endorsed by the Abe government? It would be great if Prime Minister Abe could follow the Genba example and say, we Japanese are willing to take not only the South Korean dispute over Takashima to the ICJ, but we're willing to do what Genba said, take China to the ICJ. What's the barrier to that? He knows China won't accept. It will make Japan look better. But is it worth it? What's the risk of doing that? That's what I don't understand.
I probably have some general comment and pass it on to you. With Korea, situation is more complex because this involves with history issue. Just like you said, Jerry, you know, Takeshima is in the possession of the Korean side. So normally, Korean sides do not have any motives to make a fuss about it. You know, they have it. We don't recognize, we don't approve that they have it, but they have it. So our position is basically the same with Senkaku. We are willing to go to ICJ, and we'll be ready to accept whatever conclusions that ICJ may come out with regard to the Takeshima Islands. But for Korean government, the very fact that Japanese government is trying to bring in this issue to ICJ for their eyes is evidence that we do not recognize our seen in the past for our history. It doesn't make sense to me, but for them, the Takeshima issue, according to them, is sort of reminiscent of colonial rule of Japan. And you know, for them, the bringing it into the International Court of Justice is something that they admit that there is an issue about the territoriality of Senkaku Island, which is politically unacceptable to Korean side. And you know, as you recall, I was in Seoul between 2009 to 2011. And that was the first 3 years of Lee Myung-bak administration. And they didn't do anything. But in the last 2 years, the last thing he did was he went to Takeshima. And that was taken by Japanese. Why this outgoing president has to visit Takeshima, knowing that this is going to make our bilateral relations more difficult? But you know, probably toward the end of his terms, he knows he is going to be a lame duck quite soon. So going to Takeshima is a very easy way to get the support from some part of a general public for his administration. And it is, if I may use a little bit nasty word, it is a cost-free political decision for him, because no media in Korea will criticize it.
What about Senkaku, however? Could you apply a similar analysis? Japan possesses Senkaku, therefore it says there's no dispute. And every time a Japanese politician says the Senkaku are ours, it's cost-free. Mm. We have similar issues where, you know, there's no constituency often in condemning China. It used to be cost-free to everybody condemn communist China. Now it's more complicated.
Well, I don't think Japanese politicians, LDP, is taking advantage of Senkaku issue for the sake of nationalism. I mean, you know, of course, some of them do, But I don't hear any, you know, big voices in our parliament, you know, that the same country is ours. We have to get more tougher to Beijing, you know, blah blah blah. It is only a limited number of politicians in Japanese parliament doing it. You know, in Korea, it's totally opposite. If you say, well, this is our territory, we have it, so we can be silent, we can be sort of, you know, decent, not to, so that we will not sort of, you know, giving a wrong message to the Japan-Korea relations. If Korean politician says that, this is going to be fatal for him, because he is going to be seen as a pro-Japanese, he is going to be seen as a sort of a, you know, the compromising the pride of Korean populations in the context of a history issue.
You have a complexity in the East China Sea in that you have to deal with China, but you have to deal with Taiwan also. And to me, that's very interesting. I was quite excited when I saw, despite the absence of diplomatic relations between Tokyo and Taipei, you made a fisheries agreement relating to the Senkaku. And I thought that was quite clever on the part of Ma Ying-jeou to be able to do that. But how did Beijing react to that? Wouldn't Beijing be angry by that? I would be if I were sitting in Beijing.
I think the very technical, maybe this is a technical answer to your question, but there's a crystal clear demarcation between the Japan-Beijing fishery agreement and Japan-Taipei fishery agreement, which is the 27th parallel. So up north of the 27th is a territory which is governed by that Japan-Sino treaty. And then the agreement between the Japanese and Taiwanese government is the applicable area is beneath the 27th parallel.
That practical arrangement makes it sound like Beijing almost recognizes the Taiwan government.
I think both Taiwanese, Beijing, and the Japanese government was clever, or practical at least, I have to say, in terms of not bothering those practical solutions just out of the political intention.
What's going on between Japan and Taiwan with respect to Okino-Torishima? Okino-Torishima, I was shocked when I saw a photograph of it. It's about the size of a double bed. And Japan has this huge claim to the whole, you know, economic zone, 200 kilometers in every direction around this double bed. And it got in a dispute with Taiwan over saying Taiwan people shouldn't be fishing there without Japanese approval. And you locked up a Japanese, a Taiwanese boat and a crew for a while. What's happening now? Ma Ying-jeou seemed very aggressive in responding to that. Once Ms. Tsai came in, there's been this quiet discussion. And I don't see any progress reported. But it seemed to me we'll deal with this the next hour. The implication of the Philippine arbitration award is that there's no way you can defend an exclusive economic zone for something as small as Okino-Torishima. So I would think the Taiwan government, although it didn't like the award, would be pushing hard to embrace the award on this specific issue and saying Japan has no right to stop Taiwan fishing in this 200 nautical mile area of the EEZ around Okino-Torishima.
I think I know that Peter there is much more an expert than I am, but if I may like share my thoughts about this Okino-Torishima thing, is about the application of the UNCLOS Article 121. And then I have to start by saying the two boring things, which everybody knows. The first one is that the Article 121, even paragraph 1 or 3, does not say any reference about the size of the island or the rock. So yes, you may, yes, everybody may argue that this is the size of the double bed or king bed or twin bed, but Actually, in terms of the legalistic, the solution deriving from the articles in an UNCLOS, the size, I have to say, technically speaking, size doesn't matter. The second, the only thing which is stipulated in 121 is an island. The definition of island is naturally formed area of land surrounded by water, which is above water at high tide. Paragraph 3 stipulates that rocks with, which cannot sustain human habitation or economic life. So there are two keywords, human habitation and economic life, but it has no reference to the size of the island slash rock. So the first of all, the size cannot be the major legal argument in this respect. The second thing about the stance or the position by the Taiwanese government, yes, indeed, underneath the Ma Ying-jeou's government, it was a case that he was challenging the legitimacy of Japanese economic exclusive economic zone from the Okinawa Torishima. And then the current government is, according as far as I know, are silent about this claim. And I think this is second boring thing I have to say is that the applicability of this, the outcome of the judgment, whether this is rock or the island, it's so case specific. And I think the Taiwanese government change of the stance or the slight change of the stance also represents how difficult it is to draw the straightforward solution to any of those cases. I think I will be deferring this to Peter, but even in the South China Sea Tribunal, the arbitration tribunal between the Philippines and China, yes, they made a reference to the Taiping Island, which was used as an Air Force base or whatever by the Taiwanese government, but that has a massive size and scale. And then still, they consider the outcome of the tribunal is that they recognize that Taiping Island as a rock. So it's clearly not a matter of the size. And then it's about the keyword of the human habitation and economic life. And then even if, and then another boring thing I have to say is that because everything is so case specific, even the judgment in this South China Sea cannot be directly applied to the case in the Okinawa Torishima. But of course, I understand that this will be constituting a very integral, important part of the constant evolution of international law. So yes, they have to be referred to this case as well. But one of the things which I would say about the analysis made by the tribunal judges in the Philippine-China arbitration is that they haven't spent that much time or energy or paragraphs in analyzing the accumulation of the national practices about deciding which is constituting to be an island or a rock. So yes, there should be having more accumulation of the national practices about in this respect, and Okinawa Torishima case cannot be considered only in the light of the South China Sea Tribunal.
That's a very good diplomatic answer. Infer from that the Japanese government supports the Philippine arbitration award? Or were you neutral on it? Or are you not trying to apply it? This leads directly into our post-coffee discussion, of course, on the South China Sea. What's Japan's view today on the desirability of UNCLOS arbitration, such as the Philippine award?
I think I cannot speak on behalf of the government since I left the government, but my understanding is that Japanese government is supportive of any this legal solution to those maritime disputes. And in that light, the South China Sea Tribunal is something we welcome, that Japan welcomed, as a due process of the legal, the dispute resolution. And of course, I don't remember the official line from the Japanese government, but the outcome, the ruling of the tribunal, the arbitration, have to be honored by both parties, which is China and the Philippines.
Well, that's a very hopeful answer for setting up our next discussion. I want to thank you, Ambassador Takahashi, and Ren Ito for an extremely interesting and relevant discussion. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
We'll see you at 7:00.